My name's Eddie Winters. You're tuned in to the Rock and Roll Coup d'Etat. We've got a very special guest on the line all the way from San Diego, California, Miss Ingrid Croce. Ingrid, how are you doing this morning?
I am doing great, Eddie. How are you?
We are doing fantastic. It is such an honor to have you on the program. We got a little applause for you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
We've been having such a blast this morning. We've been listening to music from Jim Croce all morning and talking with him, and we're excited to have you on. I know that you were in the process of just talking about Jim and on the program. We were playing some great tracks, and we were on your website for the restaurant, Croce's. And
Croce Park West,
uh-huh. Yes, and such a, I was telling Bodhi here, it's such a beautiful, such a beautiful idea to have a restaurant that basically incorporates a time in your life and you and Jim's life of community, having musicians, creating great food, and sharing that atmosphere. Can we just start off by talking about the restaurant and how you
sure.
just started that with them?
Well, you know, we started out 30 years ago, actually 31 years ago as of today.
Almost. Oh, wow.
We started the gas lamp. You know, Jim Croce and I went down. We never had an idea that there wasn't like a downtown in San Diego. And when we first moved here, we went to the downtown and we looked around and there were no restaurants and there were no places for live music. And Jim said, we stood on the corner of 5th and F and he said, you know what? I think we need to put a restaurant here and we've got to, you know, bring our friends, James Taylor and Arlo and Cheech and Chong and all these people to come and perform here, you know?
Right.
And just that very week, that Thursday, after we were together on, I guess it was Saturday night, Jim died in the plane crash, and that dream was gone. And I was very excited to have the opportunity many years later to actually recognize that the corner of 5th and F was the very place where Jim and I had talked about that we were able to figure out a way I was able to put a restaurant there. So it started very small and organically, and it's now a very different place. We started out there. We were there for 30 years.
Wow.
And now moved up Fifth Avenue just 2 miles to Bankers Hill, and we have even a more spectacular place. It's just absolutely everything that I would have wanted, and I know Jim would have been extremely proud of it.
It seems like such a reading on the website. It's such a great. You share stories of times and somehow a lot of the time, obviously food being a big part of, or you know, maybe not so much as you thought at the time, but being such a big part of that, the creative process and the family process, and you incorporate it beautifully.
Well, you know what? Food was a very big. Jim was really a great cook, and his mom was a great cook. And you know, I think in the olden times, quote olden times,
right.
I think we all really had, you know, we had dinners at home, and we all made fabulous food. I mean, many of us did.
Right.
And when Jim couldn't, when Jim was holding guitars, it was really my turn to be able to do the cooking. So. It was important, you know, to when Jim was performing and playing at our house, that I became the cook. So I, you know, we moved. I guess the whole story that you're talking about, you know, originally the original Croce's restaurant came, you know, after Jim and I went up to New York City,
right.
And after we had toured America and Canada, and we had such a great opportunity to really try all the different styles of American cooking. at the fan, you know, places where there were very generous fans all across this country that really shared our love of food.
Right. And you guys, you toured for a record. You guys made a record together on Capitol Records. And you guys, the story is that you traveled all over the place for several years. And, you know, could you describe a little bit of that experience? Because I know that times at that time where, you know, the money was obviously tight and you're driving thousands of miles from one gig to the next.
The money was always tight. I mean, Jim died totally broke, you know.
Right.
But the thing is that the thing that was cool was that we were together.
Right.
And, you know, traveling in our little 62 or 63 old VW.
Wow.
Imagine going, like, you know, 150,000 miles in a year and a half. Just imagine that.
Wow, that is amazing.
We traveled. You know, and the thing is, we would be booked in a place like, you know, Minnesota, and then we'd be booked in a place like Virginia or Tennessee. And then we'd be driving, you know, a lot of miles sometimes between colleges. This was the college concert circuit, and it was really fun. I mean, I know it sounds funny that I would say it was fun, but. You know, and sometimes when we didn't have the money to be able to do what we really wanted to do,
right.
It was hard. It was so, so hard. But, you know, it was a romantic time. And it was at a, you know, the 60s were great, you know, and we all were together. I mean, there were a lot of good things in the 60s. And then there were, you know, college campuses and that were under, you know, under siege. And we were under, there were places where we just, you know, we were welcomed, and somewhere, you know, we'd have to really build a welcoming audience.
Right.
We'd have anywhere between 2,000 people, you
wow.
know. So it was a very interesting time. And we really, between the United States and Canada, we traveled extensively, and we really got to know the people. And, you know, for the most part, at least back then, people were so good. There were a lot of good people.
Right.
You know, especially in the college community, you know, that were just so generous and really loving, and they were good people.
Where did those people go? That's all I want to know. Where did they go?
I don't know. I think there's still some people out there, but I tell you what, I just don't know where they all went.
Well, you know, I was going to say, hopefully some of them, they come into the restaurant.
Right.
Well, you know, Arlo is still out there. We still love Arlo. He's still traveling, and, you know, those people are still coming to his concert.
Right.
And, you know, he's a great guy. He's one of the best for me. I just really adore him.
And you know, so, a lot of people may not realize, but you and Jim performed together for years. Prior to all of this touring, can we talk a little bit? You guys met in late '63, and kind of a relationship blossomed. Did you know that you wanted to sing with Jim? Was that right away one of the first things that kind of gravitate towards him?
Well, yes. You know, the two of us really had this magnetism that was played out with our music, and we sang together from the very first time when Jim came to our house. It was in Springfield, Delaware County, and he was dressed up in a suit with a vest and a really starched, tight, you know, starched shirt, and it was cutting into his neck, and he was all dressed up. He was carrying two guitars, and he came to knocked on my door, and I came to the door wearing a baggy sweatshirt and jeans. And you know, he came from an Italian, very close-knit Italian family, a very Catholic, a very formal family, and my family was much more relaxed, and, you know, it was a very different style. And I guess I was more of a beatnik kind of person.
Right.
And we sang together when we first went down to sing together. Jim kind of joked that he was coming from a wedding. That, you know, when he was walked in the door, he said, you know, I was just coming from my cousin Patty's wedding, but in fact, of course, he was not.
Right.
And he was trying to pretend that in fact he was, but he was all dressed up. But you know, he was he came in and we sat down. He was surprised that you know, we went into my bedroom, which was the lower level of our house, and my twin sister and I had a bedroom in the basement. And we sat down and we started, you know, he started to play for me, and it was amazing. I mean, I had no idea of how fabulous Jim's music was, and
right.
He taught me about history, and he taught me about the, you know, musicology and about Woody Guthrie and all of the people, you know, Billy Holiday. He
right.
talked about, you know, Nat King Cole. They had these fabulous music that his father had been playing to him for many, many years, and he had a repertoire of over, I'd say, 2,000 to 3,000 songs.
Wow.
So he just sat down and started playing, and he started teaching me. I was only 16 at the time, and he was 20. And he started to teach me, you know, about the music, about folk music, about, you know, how the spoken word got passed down through music.
Right.
And between the two of us, we started singing together, and I had written a poem. It was called I Am Who I Am. And he put it to music, and the two of us started singing it. And before we knew it, we were writing songs together, and the first Capitol record has that song on there. So,
right.
You know, there was, it was a love affair. It was a beautiful love affair that we had. It was, you know, from the time I was 16 and until he died when I was 26.
Right. When you see the photographs of you together, there is such a just an overwhelming sense of love in the photographs represented in the music, and it's such a powerful you can just feel it right away, and it's amazing to think about the level of talent that Jim had, and when I look at the photographs of him as a child, I mean, he had music always around him, and it's spellbinding to think of this power and being caught up in that relationship.
Well, you know, it's so fun because when he was a little boy, he used to play the accordion, and they would put him up on the table, and he would play the accordion, Lady of Spain, and all these different songs that he would. And then he used to play at church functions, a wonderful, wonderful little voice that he had. It was just adorable. And, you know, as he grew up, he was a first generation Italian here in Pennsylvania, and his parents really wanted him to go to college and get a nice 9-to-5 job or become a professional, a lawyer, a doctor, an Indian chief.
Right. Right.
It was one of those things where, you know, where a pension actually meant something back then, and it doesn't mean anything anymore.
Right.
But it really was important to them. And so you know, when he graduated from college and wanted to become a musician, that was, you know, that was really frowned upon for his parents.
Sure.
They didn't really want him to do that. But and it would have meant so much to him if he had been able to achieve financial success.
Right.
That would have been everything to him, but it never happened.
There was the record that he made, the early record, Facets. As the story goes, that he kind of was able to do that record because of his parents, to kind of get it out of your system, sort of thing. And did that kind
exactly.
of kick? Did that kickstart his want and desire to take that further?
Absolutely, you know, his enthusiasm, because. You know, he made the album. It was a really terrific album, and he made it. It was not for the period. It was a terrific album,
right.
You know. But it was a wedding gift from Jim's father and mother, So what their idea was, if he could make this album and get it out of the system,
right,
and then he would see that it was so hard to sell the albums that he wouldn't want to do it. But in fact, he sold the albums, you know, within a week.
Wow.
And he realized this is a great opportunity. And so he started recognizing that he could perhaps maybe make a business of this.
Right.
You know?
Completely backfired on the parents there.
Yeah,
it kind of backfired. But, you know, there's a story that I like to tell. It was a story about, you know, Jim's dad died shortly before he made his first album.
Wow.
But he, his first real album, you know, big album.
The big album, right.
The one with You Don't Mess Around With Jim on it.
Right.
And his father said to him that, you know, when he came over, Jim went over to the house with me and we played the album for Jim's father. And he said, "Boy, I really like that song, You Don't Mess Around With Jim."
Wow.
And it was kind of strange. About 6 months later, this young woman came up to Jim. He called me that night, of course, to explain to me what had happened. And he said, this woman came up to me and she said to me that, you know, geez, I was just sitting with your dad. And he was already had passed. And Jim said, "Really?" He said, "Yes." She said, "What do you look like?" "Oh, he was wearing a flannel shirt with, you know, great, beautiful gray hair and 6 foot tall and, you know, and it's kind of weird, you know." And I mean, not that the whole story was kind of weird. And,
right.
And so he said, "Well, what did he say to you?" She said, "Well, you know, he told me that he always thought that You Don't Mess Around With Jim would be a hit." And it was one of those things where Jim called me. He was absolutely floored that had happened.
Right.
He didn't understand it. You know, it's one of those things that happen in life that you just can't explain.
Exactly. You know? Huh. It sounds like a phenomenon of being connected.
It's a phenomenon for sure.
Without a doubt. You know, talking about that period, you've... There was that time where, you know, Jim had gone into other work and there was that period of not necessarily, I guess, not enjoying the experience in New York and kind of regrouping, if you will, and leading up to the announcement or the discovery that you were pregnant with AJ. What was that fire that he kind of that struck him? I mean, I believe he wrote several songs, several timeless songs now, all in a short period of time. Can you explain or talk a little bit about that period?
Sure. Sure. Well, you know, you were just playing Working at the Car Wash Blues.
Right.
That's kind of what Jim felt like he was doing. You know, he was working at the Car Wash Blues. He didn't really want to do the things he was doing. What he really wanted to do was to make music and to be able to make that his profession. And so it was, you know, our Capitol album was not, was never, when we got to a college, there were never any albums to sell. There was no promotion.
Right.
And so by the time we got back, you know, it was, after traveling, you know, over 150,000 miles, we recognized that this is not going to work. We had to go, we had no money. And so we barely had money to get over the bridge. We just kind of threw it in there. And we figured we'll go back to the country and countryside and see if we can find a place. And we did. We found a little place for $100 a month. And then, you know, Jim started working construction. I had a friend that got him a construction job. And we would sing at night at the little paddock or at clubs around town, the main point.
Right.
And then... when I found out that I was pregnant, it got Jim really, it was one of those things that, you know, pushes you to either make it or break it, you know?
Right.
And he really, he wanted this so much. He sat down and he wrote You Don't Mess Around With Jim. He wrote Time in a Bottle.
Right.
He wrote, you know, all these songs that were on the first album. And it was just took him a week to do it. He did it within, you know, just 1 week.
That's...
And sent them up to the producers, and in no time at all, he was, they loved the music. He was finally saying, he was finally singing his heart, you know.
Right.
And that's how it all, that's really how it all began.
And did Jim immediately, once this the recordings for this record were finished, did he immediately go on the road, or was he around for a little bit during that time leading up to that?
Well, see, he stayed until Adrian James was born. So he stayed with me, and he was there in the room playing music for me, and the nurses were all around, and everybody was really excited.
Wow.
It was really fun. I mean, he was playing music, and it was a 24-hour period where we just kept waiting and waiting for Adrian James to be born. But
right.
You know, he stayed for a week, and then a couple of weeks actually, and then it was time for him to go, and he had to go on the road. It was, and we both, you know, decided this was what he needed to do.
Right.
And there was no other way around it. He had to go. So, you know, I stayed home with AJ, and he was on the road. He was on the road for 2 years doing concerts, and you know, he did 3 albums.
Right. It's just so busy, and I was going to say, when you were watching this as it started, did it, in your recollection, did it just take right off? I mean, did it just like right out of the gate for you?
You know, Eddie, I got to tell you, it was an interesting thing. You know, we made $200 a week when we first started,
right?
And we made $200 a week when it ended.
Unbelievable.
And Jim. It's unbelievable, yes. And it was one of those things where, you know, still, as much as we kept hearing about, and see, we saw billboards, you know, on Sunset
wow.
Boulevard, Jim's pictures. I think Life and Times was up there. And we saw, you know, all these concerts where he was supposedly making $10,000 a week.
Right.
A night, and TV, and radio, and all kinds of stuff. But, you know, in terms of where we were financially, it never made sense, you know. It never came down to where we were. So it was a great opportunity to see what a career being launched was like.
Right.
In business, you know. They were definitely, you know, sending him everywhere, and to Europe, and to, you know, to, I mean, all kinds of everywhere. It was a 2 year, you know, I think that, you know, in the books, the Beatles and the books of Stevie Wonder and the books of all these people that you read, all of these books, including the book of, I Gotta Name the Jim Croce Story that my husband Jimmy Rock and I wrote. I mean, it'll tell you all the places and things that he did. But the bottom line is that, you know, for musicians, it's one in a billion that really are able to make it and professionally, you know.
Right.
And be able to make a living at it. And I have a club, we have a club that is still featuring live music every single night.
That's great.
I wish we could do more for these musicians who are just so generous with their music, but you know, there's only so much you can do.
And it, you know, and it seems
it's
like it seems like the music industry then and now is such a I don't know, just a large, you know, giant, you know, organism that is, you know, it's hard to get in and then it's hard to get out. And it seems like there was a big struggle of knocking on that door. And then once Jim got in and catapulted to this fame, you know, he tragically died. And it seemed like also that there was a lot of struggle to, you know, on this busy schedule, making all of this money for somebody, there was a big struggle to get, you know, money due to Jim and the family.
You're right. You couldn't be more right, Eddie. It was like going down a rabbit hole.
Wow.
And you never knew where you were going to come out, you know. And I fought for, you know, for many, many years, over a dozen years, to get the rights. And right now we're still maybe heading back to fight again, you know.
Gosh.
But it's really a very difficult situation always, you know.
Of course.
Trying to hold on to the copyrights and the publishing and the masters is a very difficult thing, I'll tell you. It's not an easy thing.
That's, you know, you're never thinking that going into the situation. You know, it's,
yeah, you're never thinking as an artist that you're one day gonna have to fight
and to be a business
right.
person.
And also to fight to retain your art, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Exactly. Yes, no, but you know, right now music's free.
Right.
I mean, Pandora and all these places, they say they give money to the artists. They don't give money to the artists.
Right.
It's the streaming and all the stuff that goes on. It's really scary. It's really, really scary.
It's like the Wild West.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
I said it's like the Wild West with music. There's no rules.
There's a weird thing. There's good parts to it. There's bad parts to it. It's good that music can be shared at such a massive, you know, level, but it's also weird because there's so many intimate parts of music that you're missing out on now because of that.
And the laws behind it, too.
Buying an album and looking at the album cover art and reading the lyrics inside the sleeve, things like that are just totally now just missing from music.
Well, you know, it's interesting. There are things. I mean, AJ Croce has a new album out right now called 12 Tales.
Awesome.
And he has a CD and also an album. And it's interesting to read. You can still read those the inside of the album covers. You can, you know, there's certain albums that are out there. I think vinyl is getting more popular.
It is, yeah, making a comeback for sure.
Speaking of which, on the website, on Jim's website, there is a vinyl copy of Lost Time in a Bottle, the new release that we were playing.
Exactly.
That that is on vinyl, and I've got to be honest, I want to get that for Christmas.
You trying to drop a hint here, Eddie, or what? Yeah.
Speaking of comebacks, but
yes. Well, you know, you're welcome. All you need to do is just go to CroceParkWest.com, or you can go to our Croce Store, CroceStore.com, and you know, I would love to have people come and buy some of Jim's music. It's a great gift. We also have a wonderful book, and I'd be happy to sign it for you too.
You know what? I would love that. That would be great. Bodhi,
I would
appreciate it. Ingrid, I know you. The time is short. I do have a little couple more questions.
I'm open, Eddie. I've got some time, and I'm happy to talk to you. A pleasure to talk to you.
I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Bodhi,
you're a pleasure to talk to too.
Bodhi is a play. I do the show with him every Monday, and it is always a delight.
Yeah, see, Eddie was shaking his head while you said that. I just wanted to point that out.
you guys are really kind, and I so appreciate
that. Your stories are amazing. I could listen to you speak all day. These stories are so like from the heart and so authentic. And I think the most amazing thing that I've heard so far of all the stories you've been sharing with us is the fact that when Jim was playing while you were giving birth. I just think that's amazing. I feel like if I was a baby inside of a womb and I heard Jim Croce playing live, I'd be like, get me the hell out of here. I got to hear this. I mean, that's just amazing.
He didn't want to come out. He knew that his daddy was going to be going away. So
aww.
He was packed there.
There's a story and it's, I mean, I got to be honest, it's very sad to have to go through, you know, when someone so close and an integral part of your life is no longer here on Earth. And there's a story about after hearing the news that a letter showed up that Jim had just mailed. And it's so touching to me because he realized at this point that the journey had been so, I guess, rough, and wanting to come back home and be with you. How did you really, you know, how did you take your first step after this such an incident? Like, how do you recover from that?
Well, you know, you just have to get up and eat.
Right.
You get up in the morning and you make breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and, you know, you get into the pattern and you just keep going. Because, you know, life is full of travails.
Right.
It's just racked with travails and triumphs. And, you know, I often speak about, I speak to a lot of groups about with enthusiasm about the kind, I try to inspire people to move forward. Because,
right.
You know, you can't stay where you are. You just got to keep moving. And that was a really, I guess it was a good lesson for me growing up. I had a lot of travail.
Right.
And I triumphed over it. And I just kept, you just keep going, you know. I think that, you know, sometimes you do need to take time out and just, you know, be quiet and think about what's going on, and, you know, and then you come out the other side and you go, gosh, I'm really, really lucky. I got to know Jim. I got to sing with Jim. Jim's music is here on Earth, and it's a wonderful thing. His son is here. Our lives are here. You know, we're
right.
Here. And so you just keep going on, and that's what, you know, and sometimes you're lucky enough to find them.
We've lost him.
Operator.
No. Oh, no, we'll be right back. We'll be right back. Here goes.
See the number on the matchbook is old and faded. Living in LA.
One of the things that, you know, I'm remarried 28 years now, and my husband and I wrote a book called I Got a Name, The Jim Croce Story.
Right.
And it's a wonderful book. I think that people will get a feel for who Jim really, really was. And we dedicated it to Jim's brother. And he's read it two or three times. And he feels very, very good about this book.
Wow.
He really loves the book. And he loves Jim and he loves us. And you know, we've just really, really bonded over this book. This has been a very pivotal expression of, I think, closure, you know, for all of us.
Right.
And so, you know, you can get the book at Croce's restaurant, I mean, at our Croce's Park West. You can click there, or you can go to our crocesstore.com. And, you know, there's a lot of, like you had mentioned before, there is a vinyl album there, and there are all kinds of books that are there that are fun to read, and they have the stories about Jim and me, you know?
Right. And, you know, I wanted to ask you, in through this period, I mean, this book has been a long time coming as far as, you know, putting it together and retelling these stories. You and your husband have done a wonderful job of compiling these stories. Was there for you a spiritual kind of experience that you went through, you know, looking at yourself in your life while making this book?
You know, the answer is yes. I mean, I am a spiritual person, and I believe deeply in being present in the universe, and in not blaming people, in being kind, in being honest, in being happy, in being good.
Right.
You know, and giving my best every single day. I work really, really hard at doing that. So, you know, I had good educators, and my father was a very, very important person to me, and gave me great courage. And you know, people in your life, if you are, no matter where you go, there are teachers, there are you know, parents, and there are relatives that will inspire you, and that's where you need to go. You need to find people that are going to give you good feedback and make you feel good and move forward, and that's the most important thing, I think, in life.
Right.
You don't want bad people.
Exactly.
You want to be with good people. You want to be with people that encourage you and inspire you and help you to keep moving forward.
That you're so very right, because it is when you have the opposite around, it kind of tends to creep into your life and affect the way that you your day to day. And it's
absolutely.
I was going to ask you, wonderful thing. You've always been an artist your whole entire life. You've been doing art recently, and I assume the whole time. But can you tell us a little bit about you, some of the artwork that you've made over the years, and can share us?
I can share. After I went to Rhode Island School of Design, and then down to Moore, and Jim helped me, supported me in my artwork, and then. You know, I, after fighting litigation and losing my vocal, losing my voice, and having to figure out, how to make a living,
right.
Running a restaurant, I never really had time until very recently. And then I started back doing collages. I do mixed media, all types of mixed media.
Right.
And I've been really, I tell you what, it's one of those things where, I do artwork, I can change it, I can move it, I can make things happen and wipe the canvas clean or fix it in a way that makes me feel happy. And life is not quite that easy. it's really fun to be able. It's actually fun to be able to have that opportunity. To, in a sense, it's like having life on a canvas.
Right.
You can make the way you want it, and you can move on to the next painting and the next work of art, And so that's kind of how I feel about my art. It's a great therapy, and it's also.
No.
Hello. Oh. We are having technical difficulties.
Hi there. A wonderful experience for the viewer.
Woohoo. Yes, I think your phone cut out for a split second, but we got you back.
You got me back.
We did. I don't know what
my heart dropped out. I was like, no.
For a split second, my heart literally dropped. I want to say, the thing that I've taken away is that you've been able to very much be such a strong and the inspiration of. Being able to look at life with the perspective that you have is really just something that I really applaud, and I really think that also with the restaurant and sharing that experience is such a it's such a great thing that you're doing, and
it comes through in her voice. I mean, like I just hear your positive outlook and positive attitude. You can just hear it in your voice, and it's really refreshing. Actually,
it really is.
It's really nice,
and I think. Hello? Is this off?
I'm so sorry. I think that people should be hospitable to each other. I think that being kind to people, that's the most important thing of all. I think being kind to people is helping to feed people fabulous food, wine, and giving and being part of that process of being hospitable. That's what Jim Croce was all about. That's what his family and our family was about. So, that's what I want to do at our restaurant. And Croce Park West really does have everything that I've ever wanted in a restaurant. So I couldn't be happier with where we are. And I wake up every day feeling, I'm just so thankful. There's so much in life to be thankful for, and I am very, very thankful.
Well, I have to say, I'm thankful for you spending your morning with us.
Absolutely.
Sharing these great stories and talking with us about just your life and the incredible journey that you've been on. And I've got to come down to San Diego.
Oh,
yeah, we got to come down. And, absolutely.
And please come visit us. We just won one of the top new restaurants in San Diego, and it was, it would not have happened had we not moved from downtown all the way up to Bankers Hill.
Wow, sweet.
I feel really lucky. We have a brand new chef, from San Francisco. We have a wonderful sommelier, a manager. We're doing things the right way, and we're so proud of it. And you know, we feel very, very happy with what we're doing here at Croce Park West. So I hope you do come down, and please let me know when you're going
to
come.
I would love that. Okay? I would absolutely love that. And I look forward to it. And again, thank you so much,
yeah,
Ingrid, for sharing
you
your morning with us. And
you're so welcome.
Oh, thank you.
You're an inspirational person, and it's just lovely to talk to you.
Exactly.
Well, it's my pleasure, Bodhi. And Eddie, thank you so, both of you, thank you for having me on your show.
Thank you so much. And here's a little bit more applause for you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Not enough applause for this morning.
Exactly. Well, you have a great morning, and we'll talk to you soon.
Day,
you got it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ingrid. Bye-bye.